Programming using what detail, because today. His name is Dr. Henry Nakadet Olot. Briefly, his education background, he has a PhD in agricultural and rural innovation at the university, so he is now very old. He did his MSc in Rural Development, University College Dublin, Ireland, 2007. He has an MSc also in Crop Science and Laferrere University. Dr. Olot is currently the Commissioner of Agriculture Extension and Skills Management, Department of Agriculture Extension and Skills Management, Director of Agriculture Extension Services at the Ministry of Agriculture and Rural Industries and Fisheries. He is also the coordinator of Cluster Development Project, CDP. This is a USAID $150 million supported project and is also supported by the International Development Agency of the World Bank. Besides that, and before that, without mentioning years, he was one time a principal cash officer in charge of cash crops. He also was a senior cash officer for security under MAIF. He also was a senior cash inspector. MAIF, as many other positions he has held before. Dr. Olot has technical competence in agricultural value chain development analysis, agricultural innovation systems, social research, including baseline contract evaluation, and socio-economic impact assessment. He has also technical experience in rural development planning, program planning and management, monitoring and evaluation, communications for development, farmland planning, agriculture extension and advisory, capacity or community needs assessment, and many other areas that I won't go into detail. He has widely published several peer-reviewed journals, including but not limited to Cogent Food and Agriculture, International Journal of Agriculture Extension and Rural Development Studies, African Journal of Rural Development, International Journal of Higher Education. Dr. Olot, I'm very happy to have you here today as a presenter on a very important topic. And you are most welcome at this group. And this time I would like to invite you over. And thank you.
Yes. Guest of honor, the organizers, and the audience present and online. Good afternoon. Happy to be back here. No professor, some people say when they leave the gates of Makerere, they would wish never to get an opportunity to come back. But sometimes I invite you once you become. So I'm happy to be here to share with you today my plain story about agriculture extension and its role in the agri-industrialization agenda in Uganda. So this is common information today. As we say, we are now implementing the National Development Plan 3. And its main goal is to really increase the household incomes and improve the quality of life of Ugandans so that we are becoming a modern society, looking at a long-term vision in 30 years. And this is in tandem with the sector mission, the agriculture sector mission of transforming our agriculture, where we are now, where 68% of the population is into subsistence agriculture, going to commercial agriculture. As we hear the president always says, majority of us uses a local word that only work for the stomach. So, in that line, agriculture, as we see, as the view for achieving that transformation, for many reasons that many of you will know, given that we are an agricultural country. And it has been confirmed that no country has really transformed without first transforming the agriculture sector. But in this agri-industrialization, costumes. The actors involved have to get proper information, quality information, time, technologies, knowledge, and all that. And they can't do that without agriculture extension. So we find that an effective agriculture extension system is central in this agenda. And because we're talking about industrialization, we are going beyond the basics of crop, animal, husbandry, and so on. We're going to the higher levels of the value chains for service handling, value addition, marketing, and all that. And for the extension system to be effective, it requires that there has to be systematic mechanism to access and package relevant information that farmers and other actors will use. And secondly, and highlighted strongly here, there should be that strong linkage between the sources of knowledge and information technologies, the extension workers, the farmers, and all the other value chain actors. There has to be a predictable and institutional scaling process. Exactly for getting back. So, while over time up to now, the role of extension may be underexplored, as some researchers have stated, but the fact remains that it is the heart and soul of the knowledge base without which all our efforts to commercialize agriculture will be slowed. So, in terms of agro-industrialization, how is extension placed? You'll find this in documents. But as a fact that the agro-industrialization program, the NDP3, has six objectives to be pursued over these 5 years. That's starting from production productivity, consumer sampling, validation, the market access and product competitiveness, both locally and international markets, issues of increasing access and utilization of agricultural financing and insurance, and institutional strengthening. And to achieve this, the number of carefully selected interventions, and one among those is strengthening the agriculture extension system. What is the focus then of the strengthening agriculture extension system intervention as detailed in NDP3 and as customized by the Minister of Agriculture and Wilderness and Fisheries for implementation? One, is that the coordination of extension, national and local level, was very strengthened by, in a way that we should have enough human resources, not only the human resources, but who are skilled enough and equipped to be able to reach farmers, and this time up to the parish level. And the skills, as I said, should be beyond the basics of production, husbandry, we need to see that the people engaged in agriculture extension service delivery are properly profiled, they are registered and accredited. The agriculture sector is the most unregulated sector that now you will find extension workers who are social scientists, who are from development studies and all that kind of thing, because we are not regulated. So, and then we need to have the way of delivering information harmonized. There should be harmonized communication materials. And because we need to take advantage now of technology, deploying ICT systems, e-extension, you know, previously we could have extension workers everywhere up the village level, the agriculture systems. Of the technical assistants, there were diploma holders in every parish. But today, we can't afford to have all those troops when technology is available. So, we need to see strengthening of deployment of ICT systems in information sharing. The other aspect is that, of course, the NDP will talk about innovative extension models, but these have been there in the way what we're calling farmer-to-farmer extension companies. So, we'll be taking a lot into this to make sure information delivery reaches people into the lowest of research academia, extension, and farmers, and other actors. So they'll be supporting these platforms, established from these platforms where all these actors are really linking, such that the information the extension worker should be delivering should be researched, supported, and market demanded. And then the community platforms, because we have priority enterprises across the country. So this platform should be there to help in information sharing and the development of those commodities. And then of course strengthening the farm organizations. We need to go back to most cooperative arrangement where farmers really get together to produce the commodity in significant quantities, be able to add value and markets, look for markets and again for fair prices if they are to benefit. The other aspect, of course, is the issue of training vocational and tertiary institutions. That this should be incorporated in the extension system so that they pick up, they should be getting feedback from the students so that when they are training students, what they are training on is somehow relevant to what is required by the farm. All this is picked up from the already policy documents that the ministry had put in place. For example, the agriculture extension policy and the National Agriculture Extension Strategy, which have been guiding the extension implementation up to now. Just to mention that there was a reform in extension back in 2014. Remember, for about a decade, we are moving through the almost a demand-driven agricultural advisory system, the NAS, National Agricultural Development Services. By 2014, there had to be restructuring of NAS and the extension and revival functions were taken by the Ministry of Agriculture. At that time, they issued that developing a single spine extension system that should be well coordinated, harmonized, farmer centered, and with many actors delivering the services. But over time, what has happened during that reform that there is a fully fledged director of agriculture extension services at the ministry. They have to also reconstruct extension and delivery structures at the local governments because these people have been sort of all of them put on contract. And when NAS was restructured, it created a very big vacuum. They have to recreate that. And the structure provided for 5,000 extension workers both at the district and local and sub-county levels. But by last year, January, recruitment had gone up to 4,063, which then brought the farmer extension worker ratio down from 1,500 to 1,800, still high. A number of policy instruments were put in place, developed, and also with many enhanced actors, there were modalities for partnerships through memorandum of understandings. And then, of course, progressively, there has been an increase in budget allocation to facilitate extension activities at the district local government. Of course, still not adequate, because budgeting for 333 million and getting 129.5, but at least was something to keep those people working. And some preliminary studies, some people are doing some studies towards from the intervention that happened since 2015. What is the impact? One thing that measuring the impact of extension is that people have been finding difficult. But I really want to say, right now with this kind of studies, it is somehow coming up to show that its impact when you have extension workers delivering information and advice to the farmers. This is just apart from beans and sweet potato from 2015 are seeing an increase in production of some of the commodities that are just highlighted here. But that is besides the point we are saying. After the reform, some positive milestones have been met or achieved. But now, we are not yet satisfied because we are not yet there. The system as desired to be effective is not yet felt that it is as desired. And more so now, the concerns that we have? What are the key policy concerns in terms of having a strong and effective agriculture extension and advisory system? Phrase one, the ratio of extension worker to farm households for us is still very high, of course. The international standard is that we should have one extension worker to 500 farm households. But with our established structure of 5,000, these are public extension workers, we'll be having a ratio of 1 to 1,500. But currently, the substantive filled positions are 3,800 because people retire, people leave those for other jobs, people pass away. And the rate of refilling those positions is not as fast. So, 1,800, if a station worker is reaching 3 farmers a day, it still needs 3 years to reach all the farmers. So, when people say we don't see station workers, we should understand. They are seen on the ground. And it's worse now that maybe B3 and their industrialization, they want station workers up to the parish level. And remember, we already have 146 districts, and more will be coming soon. 2,184 sub-counties, and 10,595 parishes. Where are the people to reach all those places? We need to think how we do it to make sure that an effective extension system is desired. 2 weeks ago, we're having a regional review meeting with extension workers and leaders of district local governments. And something that came out strongly is that it is even worse for the primary doctors. In agro-industrialization, you know, the livestock sector is one of the priorities. But it happens that some districts have no more than 2 veterinary doctors. And they tell the saying, getting animal husbandry officers is no replacement for the critical services that the vets do offer. So it came out, what is the issue? For all these years, universities have come up in Uganda, but veterinary medicine has only remained in Makerere University. No university has taken up training vets. And the few that come out probably 15 a year, those who are self-confused where they can go. So they can't go to places where they are really needed, where there are smallholder farmers that need support. So it's such a big problem in one, when we want to develop the livestock subsector. And one thing ring around wherever you go that, yes, some extension workers are there, but the skills and knowledge are wanting. Professor and colleagues around. My PhD thesis is too much around this. But I did want to put it because myself want to promote what I was saying, but other people have gone out. This doctor will be. There is this budget monitoring accountability unit of use of finance. And this is what they have started. They have human resources there, but they are unskilled. And what people are saying, we just don't have the skills necessary for industrialization. Where is the problem? But even as we talk about the skills, is it the degree holders only want the skills? Are they the ones really demanded by the farmer at the farm level? Chances are no. We needed a lot of technicians. Now with the event of climate change and issue of labor, we need a lot of irrigation technicians, agricultural mechanization technicians. Even artificial insemination has been there, but its effectiveness, some people are saying their cows are suffering. Some will have to do a cow 10 times without success. And it's a problem. every institution has become a university. Now we have, in terms of tertiary enrollment, because it's a 2.3% at degree level. And yet I'm told if in terms of human resource planning, you have probably 6 technicians for every degree hold. But for us now in the country, I think the pyramid is upside down. And the fact is, do the graduates have the skills that the technicians used to provide? Because in agriculture, say, extension in 2004 restructuring, we did away with the certificate holders. We also almost pushed away the diploma holders. But I think the universities change a kind of training to make sure the students are get out as practical as possible way. I'm not sure what the answer. And we look at now the diploma training, there are only 3 institutions. We have Bukalasa, then the fisheries, trade institute in Entebbe, and then a little bit of Arapa, which is done on Sitema, they still maintain some diploma to show, though it is a university. Whilst we used to get the agricultural mechanics for Sitema, that one is fully now in the engineering and so on. So we don't have. So, and yet, those are the kind of skills needed at the farm level. It also came that in places where the people are gotten used to their rural areas, where diplomas in agriculture, diploma in the animal husbandry or veterinary, they would wish to upgrade so that they could go back to these communities as veterinary doctors. But the difficulty is, they're saying, because that is only a material, try to come to upgrade, you have to start all over and do the 5 years, come as a fresh. And of course, I'm saying that also consciously that I'm told material, university is the most, not very resilient, but the most resistant institution to change. But without change, how shall we address the changing demands that are coming out in the development aspects? So, this gets in the field, let's say, what is the problem? If I'm trained in, say, a technical college, in the Lira, wherever, I'll go to chapel with my diploma and start at year 2. When I've got a diploma in education, I'll go and start at year 2. So, what is different in material? What the things are taught, they are unrelated. That some of the diploma in agriculture cannot come and do a BSc agriculture in 3 years, perhaps. These are the things we need to really think about, perhaps. Even as the university is so resistant to change, but when demand out there is indicating otherwise, there are issues for serious policy engagement. And then the issue of, I mentioned of practical training. You know, we have lectures, we have field excursions, we have field attachments. But that has gone for quite a while, whilst the question is, the people out there are not as skilled. Where is the problem? So we need to look at the kind of training environment. There is that weak, I think, weak collaboration between the academic institution, the government, and private sector in providing students with appropriate training environment. And then, of course, there are other concerns of the poor work status ethics for essential workers. Rural cities are not working, they don't respond to calls and all that, and it's difficult to monitor how they are delivering in the field. And of course, currently the government and many institutions, the way we plan and report our performance is based on all those numbers, activities, not what actually is meant to achieve from those activities. What is the impact of our activities? When we train 25 farmers, what happens thereafter? Sometimes we remain at output level. So there is really need for that type of change. And of course, the multiplicity of actors out there. Even when we have the single spine extension, there are still many both government and non-government organizations doing very powerful things, duplicating their activities, which is leading to a bit of inefficient resource use, and the former really inspired us. Today, for what has gone, tomorrow, another person from a different institution, the same farmer. Everybody is doing the same farmer, from Kampala to the farmer, Kampala to the farmer, all the way up. And the farmer is really fatigued to us. And we try to do the same things, providing different messages, and sometimes without proper coordination between the institutional memory. So you go to a district where a project was implemented, went just close, you ask anybody, they have no idea. So there are all those challenges. And this is what I just added there, the issue of academic institution, the research they do, they are linked with the country programs, looks a little weak, and therefore sometimes learning is lost. A lot of implementing a lot of things in projects, but you cannot do that critical inquiry that will really bring out lessons learned and knowledge generation from all the important activities. And the university is also doing their own things, setting their own research questions. So after you graduate and see how does it really link to national development, it is a challenge. So what are my little thoughts on what needs to be done? Really great discussion of these issues. Of course, for recruitment as a public structure, government is working towards really filling that gap, staffing. But we still remain with the challenge of the issue of technicians that are very critical in driving this agro-industrialization. So it is something to really think about. Of course, there are proposals for us to have community-based facilitators, but they are not technical. This needs to be looked at mostly if we are going to go to the parish, at the parish level. Adoption of ICTs and these farmer-to-farmer extension approaches. And then, for people really going into commercial agriculture, you know, many people always shout, we don't see extension workers. Many are based in Kampala here, like me. If we don't see extension workers, the question, where do you want to see the extension workers? If I find them standing on the road waiting for you, what is the real issue? If we are really going to say, you're going to do commercial farming, that's a business. Talk about nuclear farmers, there are examples of that. So you're going to be a commercial farmer, there are these cooperatives that are very strong, very big, they do business. They should recruit extension workers, state for people as extension workers. Just like if you are, I won't see, they say, Kampala International University, say, and you don't see material lectures or public university lectures. No, they have recruit lectures. If they are to engage a lecturer from material, then there are terms and conditions that they agree on. So the local government extension workers really meant to serve the small scale farmer. The less fortunate people are really going through commercial farming, we need to really say recruit extension workers, just like the private institutions are doing already. Some big farmers are doing their good extension workers, some cooperatives are doing, so it's something we just need to accept and upscale. And government remain providing standards and quality assurance. Here are the issues on the issue of trade. Think there should be stronger public-private collaborations to really provide training environment for students so that they come out where they are properly skilled. And then developing infrastructure for training is a key issue. It's expensive, but we want to do it. What does it need for universities to engage the government, Ministry of Education, finance, if it is an issue of temporary training infrastructure, which is very expensive. We need to see our government to come in because we need the veterinary doctors. Or maybe the next month, well, more. Those are policy level discussions we need to really get to. And of course, the issue of upgrade, something that, for example, Maghera needs to consider in supporting the country to have the required labor force. and reorient the graduate research to much more strategic priorities. In a number of countries, when like a 5-year program, 10-year program is running like this, you're talking about NEP3 and industrialization, you'll find so many publications from the university in a, regarding that program, so many publications during that period. So they put their focus on the country programs. And of course, this one interested me that there was an article in the Monitor of this January 29th, and it was by Makere, the School of Education, that PhD graduates not developing in Ghana were reflected, they recently got a PhD, am I contributing to development? I would say perhaps yes, but I think the real question is that detachment that already talked about, that is it from the nature of funding that that dictates what you research on? So perhaps there is need to have serious engagement with the government and say how do they do, how to get knowledge generated out of the country implemented programs. There's a lot now, because if we talk about extension, talk about production productivity, valuation and marketing, talk about all these ideas of nuclear farmer, the farmer, model farmer, can those form academic research questions? I think they do, and they will help us help from their findings inform policy instead of against somebody. My brother Julian said, implementing a project, try to write an academic paper, you will not find the time. But it would benefit if there was a lot of engagement with the academia. And of course, this one, an issue of professionals, work ethics of extension workers. Yes, as I said, the targets, that's what everything is going to take. Do not again be reporting the number of training cells, the number of farmers mobilized, number of cows distributed, number of pigs distributed or something like that. No, we want to really see that there's something tangible. How many farmers are supported? How many farmers can make this level of transition? How many farmers are on the way to transit from subsistence to commercial production? How are their incomes? How are they, what are the volumes marketed? Those are the tangible things that we should be reporting. And of course, sometimes they say for us civil servants, because the permanent and pensionable, you're not assured of your salary, whether you work or you don't work. But of course, that's also changing, and more so in terms of facilitation. You want allowances. Sometimes money, as you said, the recurrent budgets, money goes to districts. Whether you work or not, people get allowances. So they are saying, no, probably you need to first work, then get paid. So, strategy design is only happening in some sectors like health and education, where it's after delivering the results that you pay, or they are calling results based finance. This one is something to be thought of again in the agriculture in terms of really developing the practical skills, the applicable skills. I think there's something in the districts, in the health, in the engineering, I think the best of it. In addition to the field attachments we have, can we think of a good period of time for people to acquire practical skills as training institutions so that people get out of the way they are confident? Instead of, because these days there are some farmers who are out there in high tech. So you are an extension worker, because it's not the extension worker advising the farmer, it is the farmer advising the extension worker, and they will shy away from visiting such farmers. This is for the policy environment. I say the strategy that initiated the extension reform is expiring at the end of this financial year in June. So we need to put in a new strategy. Also now taking into consideration the demands of agro-industrialization. So all stakeholders again will really call upon to contribute to this. And talked about coordination, the strategy again, and also the guiding that we should be now using the local governments as our coordination points, whether public or NGO or academia or research, so that we have a way of, or we are harmonizing the way we reach the farmer. And then, of course, some of the things proposed require a bit of regulation, enforcement, and that can only happen when there is a law in place. So, whether there will be a national revitalization bill that will be developed, and once approved by cabinet, then presented to parliament, be enacted as a law, such that a little bit of regulations come to the sense. So, what we say is, if we apply economic transformation through agriculture, extension must be effective. But we have to have a multi-stakeholder approach with all of the components that we have identified therein, so that we have impact on our agriculture. And what I'm saying here, as I said, is really information and the discussions out there among stakeholders is really about how practical we as extension workers are. Somebody wrote a WhatsApp. There is a WhatsApp group for district production officers. But somebody took time to type. I copied all this from WhatsApp. And this one person has filled all this. But it really relates on issues of, you know, extension, the skills and knowledge. And at some point we were saying this district in Tunga was a food basket, but now it qualifies to belong to the World Food Program, because everything, the soils are attended to, there are no good practices. Yet, how we get something called about Anyanga now is retired, but he had a certificate from Kalas, and became a supported farmer, and things are changing. And he's saying, for a drier Kenya where irrigation fertilizers have to be used, and they are devised for an extension agent, the agricultural officers are retired. And they are really knowledgeable with their 3-year diploma courses attended. And it's really about that. And what is something he said is that then came the era of high education as a requirement where officers have to supervise the fellow officers training, mainly in agricultural sciences. And I use the general scientists, not practical scientists at all. Most of them lack knowledge on any of our community enterprises. They need practical training and without the anxiety of exams. Just a bit of, I could recall it, just a few of those. And you see, we must translate science into practical reality. At training institutions, 70% of college time must be practical and 30% on theory. And you mentioned one only tractor is available for over 100 Makere students at Mwari during the semester. Of course, I don't know the situation now. I was there while in 1997 and I passed the tractor driving, I think, with 92%. After just sitting on the tractor, holding the steering for about 20 meters, I passed. To this day, can I operate a tractor? No. So, what are we doing? So, ladies and gentlemen, I thought that is a kind of policy issues, the concerns that are there for us to have an effective agricultural extension system in the country. That is required to drive the transformation of the agricultural sector, and therefore develop our societies, transform into a modern society. Thank you very much for listening.
Very quickly, the Commissioner took us through a number of points, but of course, his conclusion was very clear. A good extension and a budget system being central for our industrialization, I think probably that should be where the whole thing should start from. And of course, an enabling environment as well. But of course, so he laid bare before us the policy actions that I think are from his point of view and from my point of view. So I encourage you to examine the policy actions put on the ground and try to see whether you can add also expressed the policy concerns, basically highlighting the gaps that currently exist, I think, within the extension policy frameworks. He also took us through the key reforms that happened since 2014. So if you've been asked, having questions about what we mean by single spine, or I don't know if the spine is not one hand in a day, it would be as many as we had before, but I think now we're operating a single spine expansion system. It was touched. He touched some pillars of the current extension system. And I will not go into the details of all those because you listened for yourself. And the most important thing also, he heavily anchored the aquatic extension system into the AWO industrialization. Because AWO industrialization is the national thrust, where all the resources, the energy, the branding, everything is pushing towards that. And he did very well identify at least the locus, the point, location point for the aquatic extension. So I think it will be open. To begin with, maybe we take like 5 comments from those of who are physically present. The floor is now open.
My name is Dennis Sami, a deputy from Musita University. I want to thank Professor for a moving, insightful presentation, policy implications of the gaps in our extension. And I want to pick it up from there. Talk mainly well on those gaps. The structure is well exposed and I'm made to think that as commissioner, he brings us the bad news of what is happening. I wanted also to hear a little bit of the good news, which is, of course, to every side, every point, there are two sides. And the next thing is the how of how those strategies they are suggested can be operationalized. Because we are always stuck in our academic research that there is need for maybe interministerial cooperation and cooperation. But how does this get done? Because just that, we take it to the ministries and we expect that the good news coming from the commissioner will be that yes, we are cooperating with the Minister of Education, we are cooperating with the Minister of Finance, we are cooperating with public service. But then the Commission also brings it that there is need for cooperation, which implies that it is not yet in operation. So the how is another issue which I think needs to be addressed. It's true, as you said, my university, we are also into agriculture. The Faculty of Engineering at Kusitama, there is agricultural mechanization. And we still have some diploma programs running, unlike our mother, Makerere, that I think has closed most of the programs, even at undergraduate. We still have agricultural mechanization programs there. At Arabai, there are still certificate programs. There are still diploma programs. And one thing, as a teacher, because I'm from the Faculty of Science and Education and the Head of Education Department, where agriculture is also taught as one of the subjects, is could it be possible, if we are failing from the technical arm, to strengthen agricultural education at primary and secondary? We have primary teachers doing diploma programs and bachelor's programs. And then we have teachers who were prospective teachers of agriculture for secondary schools that we train at the Nagomera campus. So is it possible to strengthen this so that we do not miss out on this critical backbone of our country where at least everybody can afford private education and private setting? Is it possible to strengthen this as a subject at that level? And this again brings the question of how we do the harmonization so that your views are taken into curriculum review and implementation. Thank you.
Thank you so much. The Commissioner will answer all those questions.
Thank you so much. research to the friendly development agenda. I would say that a number of students are doing the research, but maybe on the side of the ministry or the responsible ministry, we need to have a platform whereby when a student defends at the university level, there will be a platform for presenting the policy recommendations to the ministries. Then secondly, when you look through the mandates of the ministry in line with extension, the main focus is on the government extension office. Yes, there's a plan according to the presentation for spreading out to the national actors, especially district level. But maybe we need to have an idea of any strengths or achievements, well, maybe the directions. Then when you look through the history of extension, right from the colonial times to what a progressive farm approach through the 90s, the advisory focus, where the train and visit comes to the central spine. My question around that is why the shift, what would be the trigger shifting from one approach to the other around that? Otherwise, before realizing that we are getting accustomed to the central spine, we may shift to another one. So what would be the trigger along that line? And then lastly, I feel there's a big gap between what the university offers in terms of the courses versus the recipients, the ministry in terms of the human resources courses. With that, I mean, of recent, some courses took time to be absorbed into the system of the university system. For example, the business, horticulture, land use, it took some time for them to be absorbed. So my question is, if they are involved in the traditional learning, why would it take time for the ministry to absorb such courses into the recruitment procedures? Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Andre, and first of all, facilitating this. I'm really very happy to hear this coming to the ministry. And just a quick one.
Tell people the name.
I'm going to face a room from the Department of Extension and Innovation Studies at School of Agricultural Sciences here in Macquarie. Sorry about that. I was talking about some time back we had a degree course for diploma, only diploma, and we call it Bachelor of Agricultural Extension Education. Because of the dwindling numbers, that program was shelved. They call it shell, but so that program was admitted, and we're working on an accreditation program. That if somebody came in there from Kalasa or from Marabai, they wouldn't have to start where the freshers from senior six start. Things when the restructuring happened, that program was delayed. So maybe principal, if there is need in there for. Maybe that's something that we can pay and provide it. But there was an MOU between our college and the ministry and Sasakawa on that matter. So it is just because the student numbers were very low that we couldn't just buy the program. I was going to ask the commission, that's very good. Maybe part of this budget, we could talk about graduate training, such that the ministry calls for areas of technical competence or policy of research, and part of the budget, he says it's managing a budget of $150 million. Maybe part of that budget, we can partner and say, these are the areas that we need knowledge and skills in. Can we partner with the universities and call for proposals and graduate students who can enroll, because the challenges of graduate training here is that it is tuition. Students have to sponsor, or there must be a project somewhere. Government is not funding graduate research. So part of this money maybe we could use those and then see how we can fill the gaps in there. And then I really wanted to find the progress on this National Graduate Extension Bill, because the last time I was aware very difficult because some stakeholders have put their feet in there. So, and then maybe that's an enlightened moment. I understand Makere is revealed for the future. So, the future can be 100 years from now, 1,000 years. So, so maybe the university is building for 200 years from now, maybe not, you know, the next 5 years. Sorry about that. Thank you.
Thank you very much. My name is Leon Yatomi from the School of Government Science and College of Government and Science. My name is Leon Yatomi from the School of Agricultural Sciences. As my point of question was on the presentation where the presenter highlighted that we have a look where there are no practical skills that are gained by graduate students because of the pressure they have for exams. For example, in the first year, you are sent out to the field, and by reports and things you don't have for your examination. So, because of the anxiety that is created, because of the anxiety of the exams, they end up being shutting up. So, as you know, since we have representatives from the government here, yeah, and also the college headship, can we put up a program where, at least after the program is done, we can facilitate these students to go out to farms, to go out and acquire the practical skills, and make it somehow mandatory, or we make it possible for them to do so, and with combination from the private sector, the government, and the college headship, it's somehow compulsory for you to go there, but doesn't contribute to your marks. So they can be able to get the practical skills that the anxiety and the doing it at the best. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Commissioner, my colleague, for this wonderful presentation. My name is Julius Yamasco. I work with my youth. Maybe I should be answering some of the questions, Commissioner.
Yeah.
But for now, since you're in the hot seat, I cannot look at one of you. As you're aware, Commissioner, now we are in NDP3 as we presented, and NDP3 emphasizes program approach planning. So my question is, how is MAIF strategically positioning agricultural extension services to fit within the new thinking of program approach planning and implementation along the value chain? The second one is, we are now thinking of the parish model. Parish model is what is on the lips of everyone today. And as you are aware, and as you have presented, already we have a challenge of the numbers of extension workers. So how are we going to make sure that we have enough extension workers up to the level of the parish? And then, what are we going to put in place? What interventions, what strategies are we going to put in place to make sure that these extension workers at parish level can be maintained and sustained there so that they do not move out and work for other Buna pastures in other areas? Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, colleagues, all for this paper. This is a great good engagement. Yes, the story looks bad, and I think it's really what we need to address. But the good news is that, as you say, Julius has just mentioned, when you do the program approach, and everybody is stakeholder like this, to find solutions. While the Ministry of Agriculture chairs leads the agri-restoration program, all the other sector ministries are part of it. And we have to be generating these solutions. And the solutions are there. It's about us
getting together because the people, the extension workers are there and they are willing to be reskilled if we are necessary. One good thing also that has happened, Julius just mentioned about Vaishnav. Indirectly, what has happened is that there is now more money to be sent. Okay, that is, if this the draft budget is approved as is now. There will be more money being sent to the federal governments. And therefore, there are higher chances that we'll be able to facilitate the extension workers. And all the ideas are out there, as I said, is a multi-stakeholder approach. We just need first to agree to the budget that that's the direction. I only need to check whether I know music education is there, I need to check how universities are involved in these programs. I think that will be so that the issues of discussion are brought together at one table. And then education in primary and secondary schools. Of course, it is regrettable that for a long time agriculture this time was seen as a punishment, which of course meant to work around the change. But some, and of course recently, they say agriculture is no longer an important subject. Those are the kind of unfortunate things that happen. But can we practically? Julius is coordinating a project that is dealing more with schools, the nutrition program. And this kind of, even with this parish model, one of those things in extension are saying that to me, the students, the pupils, the learning about agriculture at school, and by extension, we have practice at all. So, at the practical level, that is, but of course, there will be engagement with needs of education on seeing how to strengthen this in terms of the teaching. There was a time when we were proposing that the students would be lacking maybe half day or something, and then the rest of the afternoon they are doing something practical.
It's
now, in senior one. Starting senior one. But of course, I didn't ask how prepared are most schools with the facilities for practical training. And this is what we need again, so we need farm schools, where, not farm schools, the school farms, where students and people should be spending time on learning this. But again, of course, this young generation will not be attracted to agriculture if you are going to teach them the hope. So again, should be thinking critical of issues of mechanization. Yes, project training and platform, I think we talked about this, there is real need for that. Not only probably at defense and probably at the time of proposal development, so that we see that we engage and have inputs in the kind of research that it takes place. Non-state actors are part and parcel of our system now, the accreditation system is still a bit in development, but we now have for Uganda today we have the UFAS. UFAS as the organization currently registering the non-state actors and uploading in the system so that we know who is where and we are following our standards. But I think this should be strengthened, as we say, there should be real accreditation. If you're an organization to undertake agricultural extension activities, you should be operated based on certain criteria, which I think, as we look to do, you should be able to strengthen that criteria. The shift from one extension approach to the other is also read a paper by Professor Seman that agricultural extension in Uganda is at crossroads. But that was then. I don't know even now calling simple spying is not really anything, but as I say, let's have minds. It's not changing from what we're saying previously, the other people was doing whatever they think, and everybody parallel activities, just like this harmonized move as a unit is what we're calling the simple style time, but just about having one chain of demand and in the memory. This issue of considering graduates from some programs from universities, yes, I think again this could be a challenge that when some courses are designed, perhaps there's little involvement of the Ministry of Public Service. That sometimes draws the job specifications for different jobs. But also the other thing, they say, okay, say Bachelor of Science or Scholarship. Of course, Minister of Public Service will say this is like trying to employ an eye specialist or a heart specialist in a health center too, because that specialist needs to be at some level. But down there, you need a general practitioner. So it takes a bit of time. Of course, they say we have so many hospital farms that you realize they are not as many as we thought. And also, you go to some of these hospital farms, they are importing labor for whatever reason. So sometimes those kind of considerations come in, which later are accepted. And then after some time of verifying, validating the content, this process, these people who are training these programs are accepted. Developing budget for graduate training, that is, I think, what I'm saying we need to have this engagement. Of course, previously, sometimes projects do that. Some projects, especially with now, they do that, but of recent, we're not having a lot of many projects, and I think sometimes projects also come, they are donor funded, and sometimes they dictate what we do. But you're right, if this can be integrated into government funding, that would be very good, and I think it's an engagement that we need to have. The National Climate Extension Bill has not been approved. Previously, as you said, there was some resistance, and cabinet was sent it back. And of course, now we're planning to return only to cabinet, as they are, of course, against the recent pronouncements of magic government agencies and so on. So, we are holding on a little bit again until this process is concluded of really sure which agency has been merged with this, which one, and what responsibilities will be taken up. Students conducted mandatory skill-based training. I already mentioned that as an area that we need to look at as a university's government, the private sector, so that we have this idea of a policy engagement. And I really hope that the proceedings of these seminars, the areas for follow-up, that we can present in certain places to create that discussion on how we move forward. NDP3, how is my youth positioning? What we are doing in NDP3 is actually my youth position. The bulk of the activities under the agroindustrialization program are for and by my youth. The only issue is my youth has to really, with the other stakeholders, ensure there is adequate financing to implement all these activities. And from as you will read again, there is data. My youth budget has been cut over 50% to finance parish model, but for me that is not bad. Because actually money is going to the implementation levels. We'll find the support extension activities. For example, under the mission of the cluster development, which I coordinate, requires the farmers to confirm inputs, but some of them are failing because they don't have money. So with this kind of money, in the circles, if really used properly, in the circles that the farmers should be able to borrow money and confirm inputs, and then they will be very working well. And for parish model, apparently it is Ministry of Local Governments via heading, but for say, while government involve the farmer to farmer extension, the lead farmers, the model farmers, will help us in making sure we reach out while the graduates can still be at a certain level of providing oversight to the others. And of course, maintaining essential workers, that has been the issue. When a degree holder in agriculture, veterinary, sent to a subcounty, it has been difficult to maintain them because of expectations. But we're saying some of the people that we need, like if we say we need a community-based facilitator support from within their places, people with skills but with modest expectations, and it can work in this wrong area. So those are things we need to work on to ensure there is delivery, service delivery at those levels. Thank you, Prof.
I have only one question, and it is going to Dr. Henry, our presenter. As you have seen, there is a high ratio for extension worker to farmer, which is 1 to 1,500 farmers. And me and my economist, the resources are few. You transfer to a sector where they are what? The resources are what? So, and when you look at the agriculture sector of Uganda, more than 70% of the farmers are what? Are subsistence farmers, and 20%, I think above 20 or less, they are medium scale, and 5% they are commercial farmers. So I wanted some clarifications. Are these extension workers focusing on medium scale or commercial scale? Because if they are focusing on subsistence farmers and commercial and medium scale, are we really getting output, relevant significance output from the subsistence farmers? Because when you go into reality of these extension workers, I think most of you have experience. You find when you ask him, you take me to the farmers you've been visiting, he will take you to the farmers who are more serious. And when you, the rest of the farmers who are not serious, and most of these are the what? The subsistence farmers, who are the biggest, who are the majority, and they are the ones who are lagging behind the agriculture sector. So I want some clarification from you, Dr. Henry. How are you going to solve this problem whereby the majority are the ones who are, I may not call them not serious, but maybe they don't have the capability of shifting from that subsistence to medium and commercial farming? Thank you so much.
Your priority is my name. Mine is going to the commissioner from MAIV. Oftentimes, after students leaving the university, they try so much to find places where they would love to work. And there's this thing of experience that's always asked from students. We all do know very well that there is no university that offers a bachelor's program in experience. We've got opportunity in most of the programs, most of the graduate programs, both national and international, but majorly international apprenticeship programs. The question is, what is MAIV thinking concerning enriching its students in these high institutions of learning experience? Because most of the time, these graduate programs are supposed to be student finance. And you find out that they are expensive for students, yet there are avenues where those students can find experience from. So I would love to ask our commissioner, what does he say concerning that? Thank you.
Thank My name is Isaac Mwensi. I'm doing Barry. I'm from SAS. I'd like to inquire from the commissioner if you have internship placements for students, and if they are there, how can one apply? Thank you.
Good afternoon. I was not going to speak, but there's a point where he made about apprenticeship. Yes, that remains. When I was going to this university, there was 21 students who would be put out for some few months attached to their farms. They do some apprenticeship. I think that is part of the experience. But maybe because of resources, they now are attached to less than one, less than, how long? One month, which is, I think, is not very adequate. I know that the medical school is doing, I think they are taking their students for a whole year. I would like to request them, naive, if it is possible, if we could integrate that kind of activity, because that is where experience for our students will be gained. So that when they are looking for jobs, they are not interviewed that how much experience do you have. There's no school which teaches experience. There's no class which teaches experience. Thank you. That is what I want to look at the question at the same time.
Thank you. Address some concerns. The value of reading is about providing opportunities for internship, apprenticeship, whatever it is. So, Dr.
Thank you again for all these comments, which are very good. What does the ministry focus? What should the private extension focus? Remember, the mission of the ministry is to transform subsistence information. You come to say to subsistence, what they should be. Yeah, of course, I remember one time somebody came from the university, went to a subculture somewhere, the farmers are challenging me. Came and told me, I'm not the one who went to school, but the whole reason you went to school is that you are able to know, to identify solutions to certain challenges. And this is principally our duty. The ones who are commercial, we say, they are going to some level of knowledge and they can move about. Our duty is to bring the other ones who are stuck. You leave them stuck, you lose a lot of peace. Somebody says the poor are not sleeping because they are hungry. But the rich are not sleeping because the poor are awake. So we have to address this challenge. 70% of the population is subsistent. There is no way all strategies will be developed to target them so they get out of that situation. For us as extension workers or rural development specialists, it's our duty to design interventions that target them to change. And that is where we should be focusing. They are not unserious. They are not disadvantaged by that level. But you, who has learned what it means to do agriculture transformation, should make them change. That is why we do this process. Experience after school. Yeah, so someone has said that because education is the key. Seems when the people get out of school, the padlock, you have the key, but the padlocks have been changed. So you can, but practice, yes, each of the experience depends really on what job you're looking for. As a matter of fact, of course, some of us, even me, like myself, after graduating, I remain hanging around in Kampala here, hoping to get a job in the other areas. But I have to go to the districts and I went to sub-council, nobody has to experience for an agriculture officer. That is an entry point. No experience is required. The trouble sometimes we have to start as managers, which is a challenge that I think no institution will take a fresher to be a manager unless it's really a family business. Some of those realities have to be accepted that sometimes we want to be smarter. But many jobs to start with have to start from low. But of course, I agree that the issue of the
competence development, training, so for people to get hands-on experience is very key. And as I say, the ministry as of now in terms of, we do the usual internships, where you get a letter from the university to whom it may concern, and students can get places. It's not an effect. We really need to move into, as I say, graduate trainees, something like that. Of course, it's not yet a formal thing in public service, but it's an area of engagement that, yes, we should provide, what I said, an environment for skills development. And as the professor you have said, we used to have like district farm institutes and districts, and those were all training areas. But somehow, of course, the changes over time, those have gone down. That is what we are saying needs to be revived. And having these engagements and having all stakeholders agree that this is necessary, we need to get back to that so that we don't say students don't have experience, we're not providing exposure to opportunity. This is all our responsibility. So that's the point, as I said, for policy engagement and for to be considered. Internships at the ministry, how can one apply, as I said, these ones, the ordinary ones we don't have yet. Formally, what we call the graduate trainees or something, for people who are after school. This is done for people who are training, who are still at school, these attachments. But we are looking towards having really that proper internship. Of course, your bachelor's degree, where some really comes and works. Not because sometimes it's internship, but field attachments. Sorry to say, people do more observation than actually practicing what is there. Then you write the report. It's not very hard to get. You really start to go and work. It could be paid internship, but for really acquiring skills. That is what we're looking up to. And I think it may take a while, but I think sooner than later it should be considered. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Dr. Koroit, for those comments. Just for record, I think for the questions from students, maybe the need for formalizing that internship at WAIF, I think, should be a point that I think the ministry needs to seriously, from my colleagues over here, seriously think about. I just have one or two comments as I take advantage, which you don't have to respond to. Personally, I was amazed that sort of alluded to the fact that you don't have standard quality procedures for extension staff. What we have them for COVID, which came yesterday. Then in one of your presentations, one of the slides, there is a graph where extension is linked to production. My concern there is that extension is just one of the few factors that will push production. So I think that that needs to be examined, and Dr. Cross would have answered my questions. I just put on the room for you to note. Then who handles nutrition? It's also another issue. Because it looks like nutrition has been properly mainstreamed in extension. For now, you know, Julius is working in that area there and is next to, sitting next to you. Then finally, there's this issue of the parish model. And by the way, the parish model was presented here by Professor Suma at our first inaugural seminar. So, I'm happy to hear that it is still being talked about. But you did mention, Dr. Koroit, that there is a problem with work ethics of the extension staff. And I know that from the agriculture statistics that I see as one of the indicators. So I'm not sure how rolling them down from some county and how parish level is going to address that. Well, some of them have been running away from sub-counties. I know we have about two lecturers who run out from the sub-county. I will not mention their names. So now I think if you take them to the parish level, we have many more running away.
Yeah.
And even many more not working, but those are just points to note. So is that, ladies and gentlemen, join me in another round of applause for... Now it is my honor and pleasure and gratitude to hand it over to the guest speaker for today, Dr. Siri Munande, to wrap it up for us. Dr. Siri Munande, from what you have heard, from experiences, from your wide knowledge of the sector, what
First and foremost, I would like to thank the organizers of this policy dialogue, which is very commendable, especially in view of the cultural backbone of the Uganda's economy. Specifically, I wish to thank Professor Bashasha for inviting me. Also, to thank Dr. Opalot for his wonderful presentation on the extension system in Uganda, its policy and its plans and its implementation. Finally, to thank all those who are participating in this policy dialogue. I would like to bring global context to what we are discussing today, and then ground it to the continental context, and then round it up with the Ugandan context. What we know is this population increase, which is exploding mostly in Africa as well. And it's expected that the current population is going to reach, global population is going to reach more than 10 billion. And within the African context, the population is going to double, more or less, within the next 30 years, from the current about 1.4 billion to 2.8 billion, which is a huge increase. To complicate matters further, we have other issues as well. Climate change, which is affecting the cultural sector and other sectors as well. We have environmental degradation, which is also affecting agriculture as well. Compounded to that, of course, we have issues of COVID and some pandemic and so on and so forth, which are all human calamities which affect agriculture in one way. So we have several problems. At the same time, production and productivity, agricultural production, is falling way behind population growth in the continent. So combine all those things together, we see the future is very bleak indeed, unless we do something very urgent. We are all familiar with the Sustainable Development Goals, which has been put in place by the UN, 17 of them. Now, because of the problems in agriculture, 10 of them speak about agriculture production, productivity, one way or another. And that's a big number. Now, this has been grounded within the African context as well, through the CADAP processes. There was a commitment in 2003 at Maputo, what they call Maputo Declaration, where African governments agreed to do a number of things. And one of them is actually to increase investment in agriculture up to 10%. And this was recommitted in Malabo in 2014. Again, they agreed to put additional investment in agriculture. Well, there are problems of interpretation of what is agriculture. But in the real context of the Malabo, as well as Maputo, putting funds in agriculture means putting funds in agriculture, not roads to do other things, including agriculture, not putting electricity for other things, including agriculture, not doing education, including agriculture. Putting money in agriculture, the 10% means putting money in agriculture. In other words, agricultural research, agricultural extension, agricultural marketing, all the value chain aspects of it. Farmer organization and all that kind of thing, that's agriculture. All these commitments, of course, have not been met by most of the governments in Africa, and that's a challenge. And the few countries that have probably done a commendable amount of work and investment includes maybe Malawi, Rwanda a bit, Ethiopia, Morocco, and a few others. And in Uganda here, I think the highest it has gone is about 3%, which is extremely low. And with that kind of investment, and knowing that actually agriculture is the backbone of the economy, then 3% is extremely low, and we have to do a lot more. In other words, even if you put a very good policy, a very good implementation plan, including a very good extension policy and so on, the first thing is if you don't put sufficient investment in it, then you are not going to meet the goals. Now, coming to Uganda, apart from the resource issues, which affects other things as well, of course, like Dr. Polot said, there's a good policy now, with a number of good areas which can go into what topic today is, which is agro-industrialization. First of all, the National Development Plan talks about transformation. And transformation, instinctively, you think of transforming, including and majorly transforming agriculture, because that's where most of the employment comes from, most of the workers come from, and most of the community. So is. You think about agriculture first. So National Development Plan really talks about it. Now, going into the extension policy, first of all, the agricultural sector plans, which have expired now, but incorporated into the National Development Plan. Extension itself, when you look at the policy, a lot of areas really talk, and Polot, Dr. Polot has emphasized it, a lot of the areas talk about agro-industrialization, value chain development, and so on. And a lot of activities that he has mentioned as well focuses on those areas. Now, agro-industrialization has implication when you go to extension. Not only extension, but education, research, and extension on what you produce in terms of capacities. One of the fundamental needs is the capacity to do it. And the capacity to do it is not only at individual level. It's at different levels. It is at organizational level. It is at institutional level. It is also at individual level. And you have to have several capacities. And all these are combined to make market-oriented advisory services more effective and efficient, any system that you are dealing with. And there are three main domains of capacity, really, you have to look at. The first one is capacity to organize. In others, we are talking of market-oriented advisory services and the multiplicity of players in that. I've mentioned the public sector, the private sector in the various domains and so on, and farmers themselves, farmer organizations and so on. In other words, do we have the organizational system that can bring them together, first of all? So you're talking of a governance system. Is your governance system robust enough and accommodative enough to bring all those players together? Secondly, leadership. Is your leadership system accommodative enough? Is it fast moving? In other words, is it not static? Do they have the capacity to learn? Because market-oriented advisory services and agro-industrialization is very fast moving. Let's say tomorrow there's a strike of transporters. Can you move very fast to adapt? You have a bumper crop this year and the markets are not sufficient. Do you have capacity? That's leadership that leads by learning and by incorporating ideas, but it's not static and is not encumbered by bureaucracy. You need those capacities that we are talking about. In other words, internal organizational and governance system. Then you have to invest in staff as well. Even the organization, you have to invest in the staff in terms of their capacity, and you have to change the work culture. How do you change the culture of that? So I'm just talking about organizational capacity. So the second capacity is capacity to relate at all levels. Because if you don't relate, then you are going to miss your goal of agro-industrialization. Market-oriented advisory service is a whole chain of players. Do you have these capacities, for example, to build strategic partnerships? Because that's different. Strategic partnership is different from non-strategic partnerships. If you are going to go into value chain development or even agro-industrialization, then instinctively and factually, you are talking of market-oriented agricultural advisory services. In short, they call it MOAS. And MOAS has been defined several years ago. It simply means extension and advisory services with a business focus. In other words, considering farming as a business. And it's about reorienting from production focus, because previously it's production focus, business development. In other words, everything you do in the value chain, it has a business orientation. In other words, a farmer should not just produce and sell excess. It should be market driven. It should be agro-based driven. Probably sell everything and buy at times. But if it is food, you can basically you focus on the mass market and you keep your excess. So the services are not only restricted to producers. It includes all actors and all stakeholders along the value chain. You are talking of producers, that is the farmers. You are talking of marketing agents. You are talking of post-harvest issues. You are talking about input dealers. You are talking of farmer organization. You are talking of financial services. You are talking of information and communication services. You are talking of insurance, handling, processing, transporters. All those are actors. In other words, all these are meant to improve the chain and to enhance agro-industrialization and to assist the small-scale farmers, which most of us we have, but also a few medium-scale farmers who we have, to enter more efficiently, effectively, and with good quality into the value chain. When we talk of market-oriented advisory services, what does it really mean? What does it entail? And I'm going to talk about comparing the previous extension system, which is production-oriented, due to market-oriented advisory services. And I'm asking a question, in the new policy, which is somehow implied, because it talks about pluralism in extension. Pluralism in extension means all these actors play a role in extension. So the question is, within this policy and its implication, how have they been brought in? Because we are no longer into production-based extension, which is the previous one. So let's talk about the knowledge domain in these two different extension systems. So in the knowledge domain, production-based extension system simply means farm-related technical production topics. You end there. In other words, rows, weeding time, fertilizer application, and so on and so forth. In other words, farm-based knowledge base. But in market-oriented advisory services, it is sector-related, but also economic-based. In other words, trade, marketing, processing, value chain management, innovation system, farm organization, financial services, and all that. Now, there are certain skills which are different. Production-based, it is technical competence. In other words, you go to Makere or wherever it is, you come, it's technical competence. That's it. I know my extension system, I know what it is, and so on. But in market-oriented advisory services, it is somehhow different because you're involving many other players. And your role, therefore, switches from technical competence and moves towards what we call facilitation skills, because you have to bring into play all these people and working with the farmers. That's facilitating collaboration. It involves trust building. Can you manage trust building? Can you bring it up? Communication skills, financial services management, group development, and so on. So it is a multiplicity of skills that we are talking about. And then, of course, the attitude also is different, because generally farmers distrust the system. When you're moving into markets and value chain and so on, the farmers distrust. They have distrust about what market says. Well, I'm going to be cheated. So basically, you have to move farmers from a position of distrust to trust. And when you are going to do that, the issue of farmer empowerment is very critical. And when you are doing farmer empowerment, therefore, it means the issue of farmer institutional development. In other words, farmer groups, farmer cooperatives, farmer organization, and so on, is very critical. And I'm not talking about huge ones, but you can start with marketing groups, saving groups, storage systems, but also organized farmer groups. You now begin to move from what we call low value, because farmers, most often in their individual basis, they mostly grow low value, and they move towards higher value systems, and then value-added systems. Because, for example, groundnuts, eventually they might package it and then put it into the market. Although it is the same, but still moving along the processing system and so forth, information system and so forth. Therefore, the coordination of the system, the whole extension system is very, very important, and it's critical. Now, how is the system working now? Have we done a gaps analysis? If you are moving into agro-industrialization, and based on the experiences we have gathered so far, have we moved into gaps analysis, see what are the things? Have we brought in other people, and how have we done it, and how have we invested in it? Is our knowledge system now robust enough to bring all the knowledge that is there in the private sector, in the research system, in the public sector? The Ministry of Agriculture also talked about improving ICT's information knowledge systems, okay? Which is now the mainstay of how we work, especially with COVID now. Marketing globally, how have we really taken advantage of the ICT system? Do you have an ICT backbone? Do you have major players in the ICT who we have deployed in assisting farmers with production knowledge, marketing knowledge, post-production systems, financial management? Probably it's there, probably it's not. But that's just a challenge that we have to look at to see how it works. What I know is the new policy is being implemented. Then look at the personnel. Are they enough? Dr. Pollard mentioned it's not enough. And usually the ratio is very big. And we certainly have never met it. The ratio of farmer to extension workers, we have not met it. But how are we taking advantage of ICT, which is a multiplier effect of knowledge and information, and what we say? And those are the things. And then I'm working in Africa, the whole continent, I work with it. Some of the lowest users in the government system of ICT is extension workers. Not because they want to be the lowest users, but it is because of where they are located. They are located in the rural areas and embedded with the farmers. And therefore, their capacity to use ICT is lower than the others who are mostly based in the cities, in the towns, in the rural areas, and so on and so forth. For example, I want to charge my phone. It's a smartphone. How do I charge it? You know? Well, for you, you don't think about it. You just plug in the night, in the morning you have it. How about him and so on or her? You bring in the issue of gender. How do you bring the issue of gender issues? Because those are the majority of the farm workers are women. In your extension system, how do you bring them in? In your agro-industrialization. I talked about population explosion in Africa. These are youths. Have you targeted the youth in agriculture? And from my knowledge of Africa, youths are not going into low-value crops. He's not going to toil the whole season, the whole year, to get a few bags of maize or a few bags of cassava, and he's going to start fighting to also sell it in this fragmented value chain. No. Youth want something which is cut. They know it. I'm going to, this is the only money my uncle has given me, or this is my money which my brother has given me, or this is my money I've saved. I want to put it in A, B, C, D, E, and get X at the end of the season. They want specificity on what they invest in. It's not about daily survival. They want specificity. They don't want high risks. And if they have gone into that, have you mitigated the risks? Because, again, youth don't want high risks. That's why they go into border border. Although they get accidents, they have that 3-4 million, they're going to border border. Because they know today I'm going to get so much, tomorrow I'm going to get so much. That's the kind of thing. In agriculture, have you focused on that kind of thing? And this will involve intensification of agriculture and going into a relatively high-value commodities and quicker returns to investment. And these things are there in intensive agriculture, and it could be invested in. I know it can take longer, but it will take more money. It has risks, but it could be done. And then the difference between the youth and the older generation is they are information-savvy. In other words, they gather information and knowledge. Have you fed into that? And I have noted, I'm in some youth groups, they share information in WhatsApp about production, marketing, input dealership, where are the seeds, where are the best this. Have the government invested enough in that? Have they integrated their thoughts into that? And I know in some places they have done so, probably not in a massive scale. What I'm saying is, yes, the government has the right policies, sufficient planning processes at a national level, but is it enough based on the challenges we are facing? Population, youth, women, climate change, land degradation, COVID, pandemics. Have we done sufficiently enough? How can we do it? I think that's the challenge that we face. So I want to thank all of you for having invited me, but also for those very good presentation, questions, and so on. So thanks a lot, Professor Bashasha, Makerere University, and Dr. Polot. So thanks a lot.
Thank you.